morning, George, Jennifer, Robin, Christine, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen. I'm very honored to be here to launch George's book. George has been and is everything I can wish for as a boss, a mentor, and a friend. I have had the privilege of working with him directly for 6 years when he was my Minister for Foreign Affairs, and before that when he was the Minister for Trade and Industry. And we have attended many international meetings together. And at all many of these meetings, I have lost count of the many moments when, in a very instinctive sort of way, I will feel this great sense of pride and privilege next to George when he presses the button, takes the mic, and speaks at these international meetings and conferences. I know what is written in his briefs, I know what we have discussed internally, but when George closes the brief, speaks off the cuff, and puts his points across to the audience, it always comes out so much better, so much more insightful, and so much more convincing. He was always so clear, the ideas are always put across so beautifully and clearly. And there's always a fresh perspective, very refreshing. Now, at these international meetings, sometimes it can get noisy, but when George takes the floor, this noisy chatter will fade away. The WhatsApp, the WeChat will be put down. There will be just this silence and this rapt attention to what George is saying. So it could be big international states person, big names, officials, young minds. I feel so privileged when I'm in that room with him. I can almost feel the admiration in the room. I could see the audience is always deeply absorbing and thinking about what George is saying. And I will always listen in silent admiration, and I feel this great pride as a Singaporean. There's always something to learn from what George is saying. And so to George, I would say it's a real privilege and honor to be at these occasions with you, traveling with you. And so now it is really wonderful that all these speeches, these thoughts and reflections are now shared with many more people in Singapore. Today, we are launching it in Hong Kong, sharing these thoughts, reflections with friends in Hong Kong. And around the world in this new book, Giorgio on Bonsai, Banyan, and the Tao. Now, it is very clear to me why George makes such an impression on people. He is a real conviction politician. He says what he thinks and he feels. He cares very deeply about people. And he has a vision about where Singapore and the world should be. Armed with a really fantastic intellect, a very deep appreciation of history, of times gone by, of old civilizations and new societies, George has extraordinary insights into what is to come for all of us. This is a man who can distill very deep learning points and see trends when many of us only see random events. Some of the speeches in this book that we are launching are from 20, 30 years ago, but their insights are still so prescient. There's a deep sense of purpose that defines George. There's this deep appreciation of the cosmic time and how small we all are individually trying to fit into this picture. And he's always seems to be searching for answers to the human condition. There's great humanity in this man, and you sense all this in the collection of essays, in his reflections, in his thoughts in this book. Now, George, of course, is a Singapore politician for 24 years. He worked tirelessly to put Singapore on the world map, our little red dot on the world map. But you also see his mark in many areas in Singapore, because he has been a minister in many ministries, in many policy areas, in the arts and culture, in health, driving our economy forward, you know, being a leading proponent of free trade agreements in our society and political culture, and the list goes on. And his views are oftentimes unconventional and surprising. But whether you agree with him or not, you know that he cares very deeply about our country, Singapore, our people, our society, and where we are going. And this, once again, also comes out very strongly in this book, and which I believe will help you understand Singapore better. So through this book, I hope his views, his reflections, his thoughts will give all of us pause to reflect and hopefully to think about how we can all help to make Singapore a better home and the world and the region a safer and better place. I'm very honored to be here this morning to launch this book, and I'm very confident that all friends here today, like myself, will find this book a real gripping, good read, and will take something away from these reflections. So congratulations, George, and all the best.
Thank you very much, Mr. Fu. Now we would like to move on to the discussion forum, our highlight of the day. May I invite the following guests to come on the stage? Mr. George Yeo, Chairman of Kerry Logistics and Singapore's former Minister for Foreign Affairs. Mr. William Zheng, Chief Editor of scmp.com and scmpchinese.com. And Mr. Chong Tien Siong, Editor-in-Chief of Meng Pao. Mr. Yeo and our guests will share with us their insights on the new Maritime Silk Road and its impact on Hong Kong and Singapore. I will now pass the stage to the gentleman. Over to you.
Yeah, thank you. And Mr. Yu, why don't we open the open it by letting you have an overview of this whole topic, so that later Mr. Chong and myself will ask you one question. Then we will open up the floor for questions. No boundaries, all right? So, Mr. Yu, would you mind?
Dear friends, ladies and gentlemen, thank you all for coming on a Saturday morning. You honor me greatly by your presence, and I'm deeply appreciative. I want to thank Jacky in particular for your very kind words. In Chinese, we say guojiang, but thank you all the same. I chose as the theme for this book launch today the new Maritime Silk Road and its impact on Hong Kong and Singapore, because for us who live in Hong Kong and Singapore, I would describe us as being children of the China trade. It was the China trade of the 19th century that created Singapore and Hong Kong. It was from Calcutta, then Penang, Singapore, Hong Kong, all the way to Shanghai. Initially by trade, then by force. At that time, China was India's biggest trading partner. But the European powers took their rivalries from Europe and amplified them here in Asia, creating spheres of interest. But out of that China trade, we developed our character. Anglo-Saxon institutions, the English language, a sense of what is fair in business, property rights, accounting standards. A whole string along the maritime coast. After the Second World War, China, India withdrew into themselves to recover their sense of poise. And it took them many years before they could re-emerge. And so Calcutta, Shanghai, they receded. But Singapore and Hong Kong continued to move and later then played a role, a modest role, in reinvigorating the communities which gave them birth in the first place. Today, we see a new China trade of far greater force than the one in the 19th century, and once again reconnecting us along the maritime Silk Road from South Asia to Southeast Asia to the China coast. That which caused Hong Kong and Singapore to be twinned in the 19th century will drive us, will drive our destinies closer together again in this century. And this new China trade, this time driven by China, will change the shape of Asia and the nature of the world. President Xi Jinping's proposal for Yitai Yilu, for the new maritime Silk Road, started with two speeches that he made in Astana in September 2013, and then a month later in Jakarta. Very few of us quite grasp what was the unfolding of an epic drama, which will have wave after wave, cascading effects, eventually changing the geoeconomics and geopolitics of Eurasia. When Lee Kuan Yew passed away, the Kazakh Prime Minister Maximov was asked by President Nazarbayev to attend the funeral service a week before Easter. I had dinner with him that evening. He told me that he had just flown down from Beijing, where he met Premier Li Keqiang, and they signed a whole slew of agreements worth $23 billion, 33 projects. Premier Li told Prime Minister Maximov that China would prefer not to import raw materials from Kazakhstan, but would prefer to import processed and manufactured goods, and therefore would invest heavily in industries all over Kazakhstan, like aluminium, for example, manufacturing. President Li told Prime Minister Maximov, this is only the first step, and Kazakhstan will be the most important country for Yitai. A couple of months later, I attended the Astana Economic Forum, and then I saw the impact Yitai Yilu is creating on the whole thinking of people in Central Asia, in Russia, all the way to the Gulf. China is progressively opening up access to all the seas surrounding Eurasia. Gulf of Thailand, a high-speed rail from Kunming to Vientiane to Bangkok. And maybe later after that, a limb across to Derwe on the Andaman Sea. Then from Kunming down to Mandalay to Chaopyu in the Bay of Bengal, across the Gujarat Pass, Karakoram Highway, down Pakistan to Gwadar. And Prime Minister Masimov told me that 3 months earlier, for the first time, China had rail access to the Persian Gulf, because they already have a railroad all the way to the Caspian. And from there, Kazakhstan, Turkmenistan, into the Iranian railroad. And with this peace agreement over the nuclear issue in Iran, the strategic map of that region changes. You know, just as an aside, these are the two greatest civilizations in Asia, China and Iran. And in the long centuries, they kept good relations with one another and together helped to maintain the peace in between. China to the Black Sea, China to Europe, China to the Baltics, through Riga, Klaipeda, St. Petersburg. They are now even talking about a fast train from Beijing to Moscow, 7,000 kilometers in less than 2 days. An agreement announced early this year. Whether it will be done or not, I do not know, because the numbers are huge. We are going to find the inland areas opening up and trucking from China to Southeast Asia, which we do in Kerry logistics, growing rapidly. But it is not just overland. It is also the maritime belt. And it's that maritime belt which connects Shanghai to Hong Kong to Singapore, all the way to South Asia and beyond. When President Xi Jinping was in Jakarta in October 2013, he was the first foreign leader to give a speech to the Indonesian parliament, the DPR. And in that speech, he said, bilateral trade between China and ASEAN, $400 billion in 2012. Let's make it $1 trillion by 2020. It's already past the halfway mark. We are well on our way there. But to create this new situation, you need infrastructure. You need ports, railroads, roads, optical fibers, better airports, logistics parks, power stations. Trillions of dollars of investments required, which is why the AIIB Bank is not a power move by China. It is an absolute necessity. Why is China proposing this maritime Silk Road? As an act of, as a display of power? I don't think so. It is the nature of China that when it grows, because of the vastness of its market, naturally that growth radiates to all its neighbors. So 3 years ago, China's trade with its neighbors already overtook China's combined trade with the US and the EU. And the trends continue to diverge. And it's the Chinese economy today which is rapidly integrating larger Asia. India, though much smaller today, will grow in importance. And if we cast our eyes further down this century, the relationship between China and India will be critical. Together, they're 40% of the world's population. Both are ancient peoples. When Prime Minister Modi visited Beijing recently with Premier Li Keqiang at the Tien Tan, a simultaneous display of yoga and Tai Chi. Two ancient peoples bound to each other, recognizing each other as a contributor to world civilization. The relationship still has a long way to go before it becomes much better. But the process has started. And when Prime Minister Modi went to China recently, is very significant. Watching how the entire visit was choreographed, beginning in Xi'an, beginning in the Daxing Santa, where in the 4th or 5th century, a Gujarati monk went to Xi'an to translate sutras into Chinese. And after that presidency, escorting Prime Minister Modi through the grounds of the Dayan Ta, the temple of Xuanzang, where he returned to after many years in India. And President Xi told Prime Minister Modi, from your birthplace, he traveled to my birthplace. How these two powers interact in this century will create a very different new China trade. The China trade of the 19th century was imposed by force. It was that force which created Hong Kong. It was through duplicity that Singapore was established. It's a long, difficult story, but creating the world we live in. But going ahead, the new Silk Road, overland and maritime, will operate under a different principle. It will be like a new internet, where so long as we accept certain protocols, our operating systems can link up. There's no requirement when we trade, when we have exchanges, that we become like each other. This is the way it is today. If I connect my computer or my mobile device to an internet, I don't want the internet to mess around with my operating system. This is mine. Yes, of course, I've got to observe certain protocols and disciplines, but it recognizes a multi-system world. Neither China nor India has any wish to impose its system on anyone else. In this 21st century China trade, you will not find China or India carving out foreign concessions and insisting that their laws operate in host countries. It will be one of how can we create a community of interest? How do we respect each other's core interests? And if we influence one another, and we must once we connect, it should be by osmosis, by persuasion, by example, and not by force. And it was in earlier Silk Routes that Buddhism went to China, and so well digested by China that today Buddhism is seen as a Chinese religion, even though intellectually we all know that it came from India. Naturally, the US and the Western powers are uneasy about what this means to a world which they've been used to dominating. And when the AIIB ban was proposed, the Americans reacted in a very forceful way, persuading countries not to join. But when Great Britain broke ranks, immediately the rest rushed to the door. What does this show? That China is more persuasive? No. It shows that these are the currents, that these are the necessities, and people are just responding to them. And I think over a period of time, the West will understand that China's role in the new China trade, that in this new role, China will play very differently from the Western powers, and that therefore, it's not a threatening power. Of course, on China's periphery, over the years, dynasties have expanded and shrunk. If you talk to Koreans, Vietnamese, maybe Central Asians, they may say, well, China from time to time has been aggressive. But that is the webbing and wax, the ebbing and flowing, the waxing and waning of a great empire. But if you're talking about the peninsula, Indochina, outside Vietnam, the archipelago, India, I don't think the Chinese have any wish to convert other people to their way of life, because they know that they are different, They have enough problems managing their own affairs. Why do they want to interfere in the affairs of others? In this new world, where do we fit in? Hong Kong and Singapore. When you have an internet, companies, governments, NGOs operate VPNs, straddling domains, and in the process gaining an advantage. Ultimately, we can call it a form of arbitrage, financial arbitrage, cultural arbitrage, where there are price differences, where there are differences in opportunities, and those who are on both sides, they say, yes, let's move quickly. In the process, creating benefits for everybody. For this reason, tribal networks operate their own intranets, their own VPNs, like the Sindhis, the Jews, the overseas Chinese, the Armenians, the Parsis. And it's not surprising that in an earlier China trade, both Hong Kong and Singapore, and before, Calcutta and Shanghai, have all these tribal nodes operating deep with them, all side by side. And through these networks, understanding what are the opportunities and reacting quickly to them. Companies are also organized like that. I'm organized like that in Kerry Logistics. And for our annual report this year, we call ourselves the logistics provider for the new Silk Road. Japanese Sogo Shoshas operate like that. Many companies operate like that in order to exploit opening and closing opportunities. And when we see the new connections, when we see, let us say, Iran coming online, what does this mean? How will the patterns change? How do we react? How do we tap new energies and create benefits for employees, for our citizens, for our tribal members? So it's an exciting new era. And as an old China trade created us as twin cities, I believe this new China trade will retwin Hong Kong and Singapore. You know, I wrote about this in 1990 in one of the speeches included in the book. After Tiananmen, when people of Hong Kong were feeling very unsettled, and Lee Kuan Yew proposed an approval in principle scheme for the right of a boat in Singapore. And I was in charge of that project, so I came to Hong Kong many times during that year and always sought the advice of Mr. Robert Kwok at the time. Lee Kuan Yew always said in the cabinet, we benefit much more from a Hong Kong thriving, but we us having an equity interest in Hong Kong than from raiding Hong Kong in the fire and then no longer benefiting from it. So many intermarriages. Everywhere I go in Hong Kong, I meet Singaporeans. I go to Stanley, I go to New Territories. They say, hello, how am I? Where has life been since I left politics? The conditions are propitious, but whether Hong Kong and Singapore can seize these opportunities depend on ourselves. It always depends on what's inside, not what's outside, whether we are quick enough, organized enough to react. And the world is changing rapidly because of globalization, of social media, and all societies, to a greater or lesser extent, are coming under challenge from the revolution in technology. Those who are able to adapt quickly, maintain internal unity, they move. Hong Kong has its challenges, Singapore has its challenges. And looking back, because in preparing this book, I went through my old writings, some going back to my student days. Then I reflect that, like you, as a child of the China trade, we are constantly grappling with the idea, with the tension between identity and openness. Who am I? Who are you? One of my mentors who wrote a foreword to my book, Professor Wang Gengwu, he didn't want to be in Hong Kong for the handover, so he went to Singapore. He's an Australian citizen. and headed the Institute of East Asian Political Economy, which subsequently became the Institute of East Asian of East Asia. So I told Professor Wang at the time, I said, Prof. Wang, you're coming home because at the core, you are a Malayan. I'm a Malayan. An ethnic Chinese, parents, ancestors from China, but a product of the trade winds. In Hong Kong and Singapore, the key problem today is swept by the currents of change, by the winds of globalization, by the subversions of technology. Who am I? Where do I belong? You know, in Tai Chi, we learned that if we have a clear center, we can be very flexible. If we have a clear center, you can be very flexible towards other people, towards situations, because you're rooted. If the center is not clear, worse, if there's no center, then every movement is full of built-in contradictions, and you get a lot of pain in the joints, and you're not effective. The challenge for Hong Kong and Singapore today is addressing the issue of identity, which is really addressing the issue of the identity of young people and how they see themselves. It is not for we who are older to preach to them, because that never works. I have found in the last 10 years in politics that it's important for the older people to learn from young people. Yes, they do not have the wisdom, the experience that we may have, but they have knowledge. And they adapt so quickly to new technology, it is frightening. And today in every home now, for many things we say, hey, can you tell me how to get this done? Can you transfer me to the new iPhone? And if we want information, the best remote control is your son or daughter, or your grandson or granddaughter. This unsettles relationships between parents and children, between teachers and students, between doctors and patients, between government and people. By learning from the young, we influence them. If we want to preach to them, we'll lose them. In the process, we become younger, they become older. And we create a better unity. I want to thank South China Morning Post and Mingbao for doing today's event. Mingbao has been kind enough to translate the Chinese version of my book into Fanti. It's the Hong Kong-Taiwan version. And I'm very honored that former Taiwan Vice President Siong Chang, Vincent Siu, wrote a foreword to it. And he'll be launching my book at Jinping in Taipei on August the 28th. You know, he's the single most important person today for cross-strait relations, because he's acceptable to China, he's acceptable to Taiwan, he's close to both the Kuomintang and to the Minjingtang. I've known him for over 20 years, and when he offered to write this forward for me to launch my book, I felt so touched. And I think we are touched because all of us, Hong Kong, Singapore, China, Taiwan, we want one thing, peace. We want a world where we are no longer colonized or semi-colonized, that we can stand up tall as an equal to others. And I thank Robin Hu, South China Morning Post, so many good men and people who organized today's event, and which makes it so much better organized than the one that I had in Singapore when the book was launched. Thank you all for coming.
Thank you, Mr. Yu. I think as a privilege of the moderator here, I would invite Mingbao's chief editor, Mr. Chong, to ask the first question. Then May I ask the second question? Then I will open up to the floor, all right? Tien Xiang, yeah.
Thank you, Mr. William. And good morning to everybody. Indeed, I'm very honored to be here today. Firstly, because of the new book launch. Secondly, because Mr. Yeo allowed Min Pao to publish the Chinese version of his book. As what has been said, the book compiled a lot of Mr. Yeo's articles. Some can be traced back to 1988, I think. Over the past 20 over years or 30 years. And I refer to the Chinese book. I think this page 138 and 139. There's an article but titled of The Network Between the Maritime Silk Route. And this was written in the year 1994, which is about 21 years ago. And only lately, or recently in fact, we heard China is loudly saying One Belt, One Road, talking about Silk Maritime Road again. So you see, look back at what Mr. Yeo has been saying. He's 20 over years ahead of these visions. So it makes me, inspire me on the whole concepts of Mr. Yeo's philosophy of the book. So when you talk about the English title, the on Pon Chai, Bayan, and Tao, so Pon Chai is a small plant and cute plant. Probably, I think, it's referred to Singapore and Hong Kong. And the Bayan tree, of course, is a big and huge tree, probably referred to China and India. But to a lot of people, they worry when Pon Chai put under the Bayan tree, how you benefit from it. The sunlight, there's only one sun, water is limited. So probably, Mr. Yeo, you can explain a little bit more on this. Secondly, I refer to the English version, the Chinese version. The title of the book is different because the Chinese version, it says, Yong Su Xia De Chen Si. Obviously, Pon Chai is not there. It's only the Bayan tree. So please, thank you.
In fact, when I included the word Banyan, it was referring to Singapore. It was a speech I made in 1992 or 93, making the point that the Singapore government, the PAP, was too dominant. And because of its dominance, the people had no independent life, and civic organizations could not flourish. And that for society to be strong, there must be civic life. It's important to prune the banyan tree so that light could get through. We still want shade, but we also want light. But that is our tian xia, our rong su xia in Singapore. When we're in Singapore, Singapore looks very big. The moment we leave Singapore, we realize how small it is. And I chose the word bonsai because a friend of mine was working in Shanghai, and he was close to a senior Shanghai leader. And one day, this senior Shanghai leader met an American leader, and they were discussing Singapore. And the Shanghainese leader, in a rather dismissive tone, said that Singapore is only a bonsai. And when my friend, who knew this Chinese leader, heard about it, he was a bit upset. They said, "Do they think we can't do big things?" So when he told me this, I thought about it, and I said, it's not bad being a bonsai. Some bonsais last hundreds of years. Some are much more valuable than big trees. And a bonsai is infinitely interesting. And if a big country like China sees genetic similarities in Singapore, and episodically looks at Singapore for good points and bad points, then I said, well, we should be proud to be a bonsai. And it's kind of an RQ jingshen, you know? So I decided to put it in the title of my book. But it's a subtle point. And when my Chinese editor looked at it, he said, no, it won't be suitable for the Chinese version. So she simplified it. But I left it because it's important that the title fits the audience.
Mr. Yu, there's another banyan tree that we always want to mention. Actually, just now in your speech, I was waiting for the word the U.S. going to come up. Do you think that in China's drive for its One Belt, One Road, would it be a smooth ride? What are the risks that it need to hedge? What are the key hurdles that you think it got to overcome?
The single most important relationship in the world today affecting war and peace is that between the US and China. I think all of us knows that. Washington knows it, Beijing knows it. And in recent years, China has proposed what they call the Xing Xing Da Guo Guan Si, the new pattern of big power relations. It doesn't sound so good in English because Da Guo should be, I think, translated as big country relations. Because big powers suggest that the world will be ruled by two bullies, you know. And I don't think that's the intention, that's the emotion China wants to convey. And the Chinese are very careful that the relations are well managed. I would say this, that right now, China is probably managing the US more than the US is managing China. Why do I say this? Because the US has been used to being so dominant, it expects others to understand its system. Whereas China has been down for so long, it's used to learning from others. So the millions of Chinese students have studied in the US. The familiarity with the English language. You know, someone said, well, English continues to be the most spoken language in the world. And the response is, of course, because so many Chinese are learning English. I would say level for level, in proportion, there's much greater knowledge of the US in China and the Chinese leadership than the other way around. And because of that, perhaps it is China's responsibility to be particularly disciplined in the way it manages that relationship, and I believe it is doing so. Would there be accidents? Would there be trials of strength? I think inevitably, because each must test the other. Each must worry what the position extremists would be and take precautions. But they should not misread each other, and they should not misinterpret the large intentions. This Itailu, the Americans feel excluded. I don't take that position, because Itailu, when you refer to history, by necessity refers to the old world of Eurasia and Africa. But the China trade did not stop in the old world. When I was at Harvard Business School, I remember doing a course on the development of US economic history during the days of David Crockett, the fur trade. What was the principal market for the fur? It was Manchu China. The clipper trade, which brought so much trade to the whole North New England coastline, where did that wealth come from? From Qing China. And James Watt, the Hong Konger who worked in the New York Metropolitan Museum, he told me, in many of the old houses along the New Hampshire main coast, there are still artifacts from the Qing dynasty, which are still in crates, in basements and attics. Ships going back, they needed ballast, so they brought pottery and furniture. If you go to the Peabody Museum, you have a sense of that treasure trove. And we go down to South America. There was a branch of the China trade from Spain to Mexico, from Acapulco to Manila, which brought Spanish silver to the China coast. And it's because of the Spanish silver dollar that today we have the Hong Kong dollar and the Singapore dollar, and not the Hong Kong pound and the Singapore pound. And China's latest moves in Latin America, proposing to build a railroad from Brazil to Peru so that the countries of the southern cone, the Mercosur countries, will have real access to the Atlantic, it's all part of the China trade of the 21st century. So I think in the end, this new trade will engulf the world. It will not just be China, it will be China, it will be the US, Japan, Europe, the BRIC countries, overlapping networks, which will give the people of Hong Kong and Singapore abundant arbitrage opportunities and plenty of scope, plenty of opportunities to make a good living for ourselves.
I would like to open the floor for questions. That gentleman, please wait for the handsome young man going to pass you the mic. In fact, I prepared 25 questions, but I have to give it up.
Good to see you again, Hilton.
Yes, a very quick one. I'll keep it short.
Please.
Between Singapore and Hong Kong, would you suggest the immediate priorities how we both could get started? Because we all believe in that, but we are working together. We have strengths and weaknesses separately, but together, we will make it 2 equals 5. So would you suggest some priorities how we can both start working together and not getting in each other's way? Thank you.
Follow the trends, and the trends are dramatic. Coastal China has become expensive, more expensive than all of ASEAN except Singapore. The result is an outflow of investments from China to Southeast Asia. And there was a report, I think 2 months ago, probably by ANZ Bank, that Southeast Asia may overtake China as a factory of the world. And all the Southeast Asian countries are doing well. And Hong Kong entrepreneurs, Hong Kong businessmen must follow this China flow into Southeast Asia. It's not just from China, it's also from Japan, Korea, other countries coming in to exploit the advantages of the ASEAN economic area and cost advantages and resource advantages and better connectivity by sea and by land. For this reason, Hong Kong's foreign policy now is to engage ASEAN in a deep way and to have a free trade agreement with ASEAN. And Singapore is a key partner for Hong Kong in this regard because this will give Hong Kong a new boost into the future.
The big companies, they are already planning ahead. But it's the medium-sized and small companies in Singapore and Hong Kong who I think a little more can be organized between the trade associations and the government institutions on both sides to put them in the categories which can move the fastest.
Hong Kong has a very active trade office in Singapore. Hong Kong will need trade offices in every country in ASEAN and work with the trade offices of every ASEAN country. I believe between Singapore and Hong Kong, the relationship is already very good. There's a lot of exchanges, mutual learning, cooperation. But between Hong Kong and the other countries of Southeast Asia, there's still a long way to go.
Hong Please. Kong, we have many SMEs organizations, and they are expecting the government to help them more. But I believe that they themselves will find their own way. The most important thing is to build up the contacts. And once you have the contacts, both the Singapore companies and Hong Kong companies will be able to do business.
Anyone else? We have a lady behind there holding a paper. Would you mind to identify yourself, your name, which organization you work for, so that Mr. Yu is able to answer the question better?
Hi, good morning. I'm Vivian Low from Millennium Hotels and Resorts. Mr. Yu and Mr. Chang and also Mr. Song, good morning. Thank you very much for your time. I would like to say thank you very much for your speech. After that, I would go and buy your book right away and read it. Anyway, my question is that with the One Belt, One Road strategy, how would you see this strategy going to benefit the intra-Asia tourism in the long run?
Tourism will be a huge industry. It's already growing rapidly. It will continue to grow much faster than trade and other industries. And people want to travel. People want to understand cultures. And I think this is very good for the development of a commonwealth. Because when people travel initially just to shop, to see things, then they make friendships, sometimes they fall in love, and bonds of entanglement will naturally grow. And business opportunities, of course. But the difficult thing is how to build trust. Because to do business, to interact, we need trust. And when people travel, they encounter problems because of cultural difficulties. And those of us who are in this business can help bridge the gaps and make travel easier, make it less difficult, therefore encouraging the flow. You know, much has been talked about the relations between China and Japan. But if you go to the Ginza today, if you go to the hot springs, Chinese tourism is a new force in Japan, and it's bringing benefits to so many people of different age groups. And the Japanese government is actively promoting Chinese tourism. Because of this, I don't think that relations between Japan and China will get too bad, because in the end, people have got to make a living. And human beings, when it comes to having bread on the table and a roof over their heads, take a practical view of things. Anyway, that's my hope and my wish.
I think that gentleman... Ah, okay. Sorry. Let me allow Ambassador Agawam, to ask the first question. Then it will be your turn. Then Hanshi, it will be yours.
Thank you so much. I didn't mean to jump in the queue, but Minister Yeo, just to add to what Jacky said, that it's an honor to be here today and hear you speak on a topic which is of deep and abiding interest to all of us. In your book, I was particularly struck by your constant thought, your constant concern, your constant emphasis on Asia and the future of Asia, which is a hallmark of a true statesman for Asia. So you belong not just to Singapore, but to all of us in Asia. And just for the benefit of audience, I wanted to mention that you are also the recipient of one of India's highest civilian honors, so one of the very few foreigners who actually got that honor. And you are now steering. A very noble project of revival of the ancient Nalanda University, a thought whose seeds you helped sow a few years ago. So a very new and exciting challenge and opportunity for you as Chancellor of the Nalanda University. My brief question was slightly different. I know that in your capacity as a foreign minister and afterwards you have been constantly involved with that. Given the current geopolitical situation and developments, how do you see the future of ASEAN? I mean, what are the challenges for ASEAN and how do you see it evolve? Thank you.
Professor Wang Gengwu describes Singapore, and I think it applies to all of ASEAN, as the region where the mandalas of China and India overlap. And you find traces of India and China in every country in Southeast Asia, going back to the earliest periods of human habitation. Because we are islands and peninsulas, there are no all-encompassing empires. And perhaps neither China nor India would allow an encompassing empire to develop in Southeast Asia, because this is their lifeline for the maritime Silk Road. What's keeping ASEAN together is because each by itself is too small, too fragmented, to be able to negotiate on any basis of equality with a large country like Japan or China or India. But together, we strengthen our collective position. And by being completely non-threatening, not having nuclear weapons or ICBMs, we are safe for everybody. And everybody wants ASEAN to cohere, because otherwise, ASEAN becomes a problem to them. If ASEAN is divided, balkanized, China, the US, Japan, India will all be dragged in. So the genius of ASEAN policy is in some ways in our weakness, in our omnidirectional relationships. And over the years, a certain group culture has developed among ministers, leaders, civil servants, business leaders. Today, except for Myanmar, there is visa-free access for all ASEAN citizens in every ASEAN country. Singapore is the most ASEANized ASEAN country because you find large contingents of all the other nine in Singapore, studying there, working there, keeping bank accounts there, having medical treatment there, attending schools there. And we find this happening throughout Southeast Asia. And our internal connectivity is improving by the day. There are problems, yes, but I believe that given the thickening relationship, these problems will be set in perspective and will be kept within bounds.
Gentleman in the orange shirt. Yeah.
I'm very happy to meet you today. I know you are the old Malayan, and I'm also an old Malayan. But you stay in Singapore, I stay in Hong Kong. I have been in Hong Kong for 50 years. I'm an old Malayan from Penang. All right. Just now, you talk about Kazakhstan. I just came back from Kazakhstan. It is very, very impressive country. They have moved from the old capital, Almaty, to a new capital called Astana. It seems that for the Silk Road, they know better than any country in that regions plus this regions. They have already built up the new capital in Astana for about 18 years already. I was very, very impressed by all the races. They have 131 races, though majorities are Muslims. But they live very, very peacefully. And to me, it gives me a very, very good impression. My question is, to be a Malayan like you and to be a Malayan like me, we will continue to live in these regions like the Kazakhstan. And why they move from Almaty to Astana? That they know already for 18 years to move this to the capital Astana. May I know these questions from you? May I know the answers from you? Thank you very much.
What's the question again?
The question is...
I find myself in agreement with everything you say.
Okay, the question is, the Kazakhstan people, they already know what will happen now, the Silk Road. To me, the big impression. They already built from the old capital, Almaty, to the new capital, Astana. So a lot of construction, a lot of hotels, a lot of new buildings are already built there. Thank you.
Kazakhstan is in this favorable position because of good leadership by President Nazarbayev. I know he's criticized for some things, but without him, history in Central Asia, after the collapse of the Soviet Union, could have turned out very differently. When that happened, there was every danger that the whole of Central Asia would implode, creating problems of extremism, separatism, terrorism. China proposed the SCO. Russia supported it. The key country in Central Asia for the SCO was Kazakhstan. And Nazarbayev had the wisdom, the intelligence, the skills to keep close to both Russia and to China. He's only 17 million people. On 2.7 million square kilometers of the Earth's surface, probably every element in the periodic table can be found there. They're engaging China now. 17 million people against 1.3, 1.4 billion people. That's like plugging your little handphone into a power station. It can be very dangerous. President Xi Jinping, when he was in Astana, just before the 70th commemoration of end of Second World War in Moscow, he said, because he knows that the Kazakhs do not want just to be a carpet for people to walk across, for pipelines and railroads and highways. They want to be their own economy, adding their own value. So President Xi Jinping made a very interesting comment. He said, let us align our economic policies. In other words, you have your economic policies, which we respect. We have ours. Let's find ways to work together for mutual benefit. And if Kazakhstan were to do that together with other countries in Central Asia, with Russia, then all would benefit. But this requires, as you say, respect of diversity, of people who are not like yourself. I think a quarter to a third of Kazakhs are ethnic Russian, believers of the Orthodox Church. They're Buddhists. So if you are not respectful of others, you have no time for trade. You'll be fighting each other within your country.
Fifth row. The gentleman with a white shirt. Yeah.
Hello, Mr. George. I'm Toh Han Chi, a Singaporean working in FTI Consulting. When you're a foreign minister, you are a great credit to my country and you are very knowledgeable of China and ASEAN. What I want to know is, how do you think China will address the challenges to One Belt, One Road from the historic distrust of some Asian countries? Because Vietnam plans to build a high-speed rail between Ho Chi Minh City and Hanoi, but Vietnam prefers to buy a Japanese high-speed rail, which is much more expensive and takes more years to build than a Chinese high-speed rail.
I think it's included in the book, but Vietnam has a profound love-hate relationship with China. I've crossed that border last year from Hanoi to Bac Nhang to Lang Son to Ping Siang and then to Nanning. I wanted to hop on board a Kerry logistics truck. They said I couldn't do that. So in the end, I traveled in the car. My colleagues in Nanning picked me from Lang Son. During the war in 1978-79, Lang Son was flattened by the Chinese after they crossed the mountain passes at enormous cost to lives. Today, there's a very active border trade, both the crossing to Nanning and the crossing to Kunming. On the Chinese side, all 6-lane highways. On the Vietnam side, 6-lane highways on the way there. I think the economies are too integrated now for relations to get too bad. But all countries want to diversify. No country in ASEAN, no country on the Chinese periphery wants China as an enemy. But all want Japan as a friend, all would want the US as a friend, and to derive benefits from all parties. And why not? In ASEAN, the North-South connections are mostly financed by China. The East-West connections are mostly financed by Japan. When I was trade minister and foreign minister, I said, well, that is our policy. Then we get a nice grid financed by other people. But we can only adopt that strategy if we are impartial, if we are genuinely fair and friendly to all parties, and not take sides unless it's in our own core interest.
I realize that I've been giving a lot of opportunities here. Is there any, okay, the gentleman with a jacket, yeah, at the sixth row or seventh row?
Thank you so much, George, for inviting. My name is William from Hanlon Properties. And I meet a lot of Singaporeans in Hong Kong, and they are very proud of Singapore. But I meet a lot of honkies, and they always compare with Singapore. And they say they like Singapore's public housing, they like Singapore's NPF. Seems that they are very jealous of Singapore. And as a Singapore living in Hong Kong, what do you suggest like Hong Kong to find its competitive edge, or what you call the center? Because I think we collab, because it's very interesting you put Hong Kong-Singapore relationship on the title, and I think this relationship is always intriguing because we collaborate on some point, but we sort of compete on the other hand. Thank you.
Well, my principal worry is that the political system in Hong Kong today makes it very difficult for the government to do big things. And if you don't do big things, you will not feel it now or in the next few years. You feel it 10 years from now, 20 years from now. Imagine Hong Kong without Jet Lap Kok Airport, which was an idea initiated by David Wilson, the second last governor of Hong Kong. And when he proposed it, many people thought that it was just a last maneuver by the British to cream off Hong Kong before they leave. But they might have derived some benefits. But the principal objective was to secure the long-term future of Hong Kong. I remember in Singapore at that time, among the ministers, we were doubtful that such an enormous project could be justified. Just as today, I cast doubt upon this Beijing to Moscow railway. Until one day, when I visited Hong Kong, I was given a helicopter ride, about 1,000 feet flying above Kwai Chung area, and I could see in one vast panorama the construction work going on. When I went back to Singapore, I said, this is dead serious. There were implications for Singapore. When we built MRT, we learned from the MTR. When Hong Kong built Chiat Lap Kok, Anson Chan requested from me permission to visit Changi Airport, to learn from Changi Airport. I said, of course, we learn from each other. Today, yes, you're right, Singapore has a better public housing scheme than Hong Kong, but Hong Kong has a better public transportation scheme than Singapore. So, and Hong Kong has the advantage and the disadvantage of being one country, two systems. You have China helping you, supplying you, keeping you going, and you don't have to spend 5-6% of your GDP on defense, which you have to spend in Singapore. But sovereignty can also be sweet because you have your own destiny. So we all operate within our own constraints. And the two cities are so similar. Any public official, any businessman studying a problem will always say, how would this be done in Singapore? And in this constant comparison, the connections are forged, and which makes us closer and closer together.
We have that gentleman at fifth row.
My name is Pablo Elton. I work in Hong Kong in the educational sector. George, a question for you. You have been appointed by one of the most important leaders in the world, Pope Francis, in the Council of Economy. So in the past 2 years, I think you have been quite close to his thinking. My question is related with the new role of China in the world. We have been talking a lot about technical and financial things, but maybe with the view you have also from Rome, you can give us also an insight about how we align our ethical systems. Europe and America are born in a Christian society. Asia has not been evangelized. I think we all men have the same set of values, okay? But when there is a new integration like this, how do you have anything to say about how do you think the ethical values will align?
Before I knew that I'll be involved in the Vatican administrative reform in July 2013. I had written an essay for the Globalist comparing Francis to Xi Jinping. They were appointed around the same time. Both were fed up with the corruption around them. Both were determined to live simple lives and to reform their communities from the bottom up. Each has a membership of over a billion. Both operate highly centralized systems. One a bureaucracy of mandarins, the other a bureaucracy of clerics. And it was interesting how the two men are now moving in parallel in two very different spheres. And both worry a lot about values, about the relationship among human beings. For Xi Jinping, public service from the days he was sent down to the countryside is a high ideal. Francis describes public service as the highest calling a person can have, because it is in politics that you can affect the greatest numbers. It's a short essay in the book. I recommend it to you as a publicity.
May I have last two questions? Okay. I think that gentleman is the fastest.
Hi, I have a question. So,
please identify yourself.
Oh, my name is Tuan. I'm an American. I work here for Google, especially specifically looking over videos such as YouTube. My question goes to is about digital. Digital has really made a huge impact on trade, especially with the proliferation of the internet and peer-to-peer messaging such as WhatsApp or WeChat or Line. It's had a huge impact in positive ways, like small, medium businesses being able to expand their markets, as well as there are negative impacts such as censorship or issues around intellectual property and the protection of it. So my question to you is, how do you see the future with digital's impact, such as the opportunities, as well as the major challenges for trade to really continue in the new century?
Because of the processing power each of us has in our pocket, human beings are becoming more equal than ever before from the information viewpoint. In the past, hierarchies were maintained by ignorance, by monopoly of information, by control of information. Today, it's very difficult. If you're a teacher and you expound on the subject, the students are Googling under the desk. And then a limp hand goes up. Oh, by the way, could it be something else? If you as a teacher scolds the students for Googling during classroom and bans them from the internet so that you have a monopoly of knowledge, they will lose all respect for you. Before you see your doctor, you have already Googled your symptoms. And after you have seen him, you've already Googled the side effects of his prescription. And if a doctor fights this, if he doesn't respect our access to information and knowledge, the relationship is not possible. And as parents, we can no longer lecture to our children in the old way because they won't accept it. So this has got a corrosive effect on all hierarchies, on the Catholic Church, on China, on Hong Kong, on Singapore, in universities, in companies. And those of us who recognize it, who are able to operate like Google and Facebook, they're able to tap the active intelligence and creativity of many human beings instead of depending just on a few people at the top. For China, it's very interesting because China is now using the internet as a way to overcome an age-old problem of Chinese organization, which is the many layers. It's always been a vast country with many layers. And like in the Zhang Yimou's movie, you know, Qiu Ji Da Guan Si, you go round and round and round and round, you can never surface a grievance. But today with the internet, monitoring the big data on a community, you can sense where there's a fever, where there's an inflammation, where there is paralysis, by monitoring big data. And then once you know, you zero in. It's almost like a Zhongyi, traditional Chinese medicine way of looking at, you know, your tongue, your feeling your pulse, looking at your eyes, just assessing the general condition. China today probably has the most advanced internet space in the world in terms of the liveliness of social networking, payment system, the Uberization of its economy. It's amazing unto itself. But the government is also at it. They have a whole army of young people managing the internet space in China. Not all censorship, but also to shape it, to moderate it. So you remember when they had this movie on the environment in China called Inside the Dome, Chongting Tianxia. Within a few weeks, 200 million viewers. Then they decided that it was creating a fever in China. So they quickly clamped it down. Not that they were afraid of information. They themselves were very seized by the problem. But they knew that beyond a point, the social media, instead of helping to focus attention on the problem, makes it more difficult to solve. So this approach towards governance using big data in the social media is novel. The US Western intelligence agencies use it to monitor terrorism traffic. But China, I think, is the first country using it to monitor the health of a community. And this is very interesting. It is something that we can all learn from China.
May I invite Mr. Chong to appoint the last one to ask the question? Sorry, MC.
Yeah, I suppose there are a lot of questions from the floor, but probably time is constrained. So thank you, William. I got the last chance to ask questions. And I come back to the book again, the English and the Chinese. The English version, Ponjai, Paiyan, and Tao. But in Chinese, there's no Tao. Yong Su Xia De Chen Shi. Tao is a Taoism, and all we know is from Laozi philosophy. And Mr. Charles always said he's proud to be a Taoist. He claimed himself he's a Taoist, although he's a Catalyst.
Philosophically,
okay, anyway. And also, Mr. George is championing for the revival of the Nalanda University. And I just heard he's the chancellor of the university. Congratulations. And Mr. George also get very close with the Singaporeans of different races, different religions. And we know One Belt, One Road is across so many countries, across so many religions. So how important is this multi-aspects of in culture, in religion, to Singapore and to Hong Kong especially, do you think?
I think this is important as a human being. We're all different. Every child is different. And if we want them to be equal, we will harm them. A unity based upon conformity is a false unity, it's a brittle unity. A unity, to be real, recognizes, accepts, respects individuality. That each is a separate creation with its own name, with its own history. Even when they are twins, they are different. How do we manage differences? We invite... Yesterday was the Eid. After 1 month, Muslims broke their fast, so it's a big festival. But during that 1 month, they didn't eat. If you have Muslims in your community, and you disregard that, it's very difficult to win them over. If you invite a Jewish friend to dinner, and you know that he eats kosher, and you don't take that into account, yes, he can do business with you, but he'll say, well, okay, I'll do business with you, but that's all I'll do. We live in a community where when you have a guest list, we say, okay, who are the Jews? Who are the Muslims? Are they Indians? Okay. Are they vegetarians? Okay. But are they Chinese vegetarians? Because many of them don't eat onions and garlic. So ability to sense differences and to respect differences and to accommodate each other within reasonable bounds is very important for the building of relationship. If I don't respect you, you don't respect me, how could we have a relationship? And I believe living in the environments that we have in Singapore and Hong Kong, we learn from a young age to handle with diversity. And this advantage is not easily codifiable. This a consultant can't give you. This is a skill you can't buy. You have got to grow up in the environment, which is why I said shaping the identity of the young, which requires us first to learn from them, is critical to our future. And we want them to grow up confident in their own identity, because if you're not confident in your own identity, you are full of insecurities and prejudices. But if you know who you are and where your center is, I think you are very accepting of people. This is a Tai Chi principle.
Thank you.
Thank you, gentlemen.